Today, I'm going to go over a GI map stool test result and help you explain what it means, so stay tuned. Hey there, if you're new here, my name's Amanda Malacheski. I'm a certified functional nutrition health coach and a digestive and allergy detective. For tips and tricks on how to resolve your digestive challenges for good, please consider subscribing and be sure to hit the bell to be notified when I post a new video every week. So you ran a GI map stool test to see what was going on in your belly, but now what? By the end of today's video, you'll have a general idea of how to interpret your GI map stool test, and you'll have an idea of which things are really concerning and should take you to your doctor right away, and which things are more to be dealt with on the diet and lifestyle front with someone like me. I like to use the GI map stool test with my clients who haven't made really good progress by using their basic digestive supports. So I'd like to help you understand how to use this wonderful tool. So let's get started. All right, so the GI map is a stool test by Diagnostic Solutions Laboratory, and it's designed to give you an idea of what is living in your digestive tract from a single stool sample that you collect at home and send back to the lab. And I really like this test because it gives you a lot of really great information that can kind of help you guide your approach to how you're healing your gut. However, no test is absolutely perfect, and a lot of people sometimes get a little carried away with the results of this test and what it really means. We do have to be careful about making leaps of logic or jumping to conclusions that aren't supported by research. So I want to talk a little bit about what some of these things are and how to properly interpret this test. And before I go any further, I should definitely give a medical disclaimer. Nothing I'm about to say in this video should be construed as direct medical advice. And if you have any questions whatsoever about what you're seeing in your test result, you should absolutely go make an appointment to talk with your doctor or other healthcare provider. Okay, so here is a GI map stool test result. And it's basically 4 pages full of information about the bacteria, yeasts, parasites, and even viruses, and sometimes worms that might be living in your digestive tract. And I want to mostly discuss the sections about bacteria, but I want to touch briefly on the parasites and yeasts first. On the 4th page, you'll find the results that deal with parasites and worms. And these organisms are very tricky to actually find on any kind of stool test. The thing that distinguishes the GI map is that it can detect very small quantities of DNA from these organisms. And so it might find something that another test that just involves looking at stool samples and looking for eggs and other various body parts of parasites may not find. The trick is that sometimes the levels of these things that you find might represent a residual infection that you're no longer infected with. So the relative abundance of those organisms can matter for how seriously you want to take these results. And then the next section is the fungi section. And the most famous resident of this section is, of course, Candida, which is can be a pathogenic yeast. And Candida is also really difficult to find on tests. It doesn't culture very well, and so it can be tricky to find out if you actually have a yeast problem. If Candida actually shows up on your GI map, it's usually a pretty good indicator that there actually is a yeast overgrowth. And then treating this is something that you definitely want to discuss with your doctor or other healthcare provider. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about bacteria. I think this is the part of the test where people often get a little bit misguided. They see a bacteria result and they think, oh, I need antibiotics, or I need to do a really intensive antimicrobial treatment protocol to deal with the bacteria on my test. And this isn't necessarily true. So let's kind of break this down and look at the different bacterial sections. The first one is on page 1, and these are bacteria that are pathogenic. So these are things like C. diff or infectious E. coli varieties that can make you very, very sick. Some of them are actually very dangerous and pathogenic. So this can sometimes give you some insights into that. Certainly if one of these bacteria on this first page is elevated above the reference range, this is something you definitely want to talk with your doctor about. And similarly, on the 2nd page of the test is the H. pylori results. And so it gives you an idea about whether or not you have H. pylori, and it also tests for these virulence factors. So I think it kind of types the different kinds of H. pylori, and some of them are much more virulent than others. And these more virulent strains can actually be more likely to cause other kinds of side effects and medical problems later on, the longer that you have H. pylori. So definitely, if you have a positive result on H. pylori, this is also definitely something to talk with your doctor about treating. Research shows that H. pylori infection is definitely correlated with ulcers and gastritis, but long-term infection, especially with the more virulent strains, can be a risk factor for cancer. Now, the next section is the part that talks about your beneficial bacteria, and it kind of gives you some idea of the relative abundance and ratios of different orders and classes and groupings of beneficial bacteria. And a lot of people can get a little bit mixed up about these results and think, oh, it shows that I have this bad ratio, and that means I need to do something specific about my health. And this is really off the mark, unfortunately. And the reason is that the study of the microbiome and sort of what's ordinary and normal is very much in its infancy. And we really, really don't know what these results really mean or indicate. There's been no really clear correlation. There's been some suggestions in studies and things that it looks like are correlated. The most famous example is certain ratios of the Firmicutes to Bacteroides groups of bacteria are supposed to correlate with obesity. And so obese people are supposed to have a different ratio than people who are not obese. So there is some correlation, but correlation is not causation. And we can't necessarily make these conclusions yet. And so basically what this tells me is you have a unique blend of microbiome in your gut, and that's about all we can say from this. Unless some of these bacteria are all wildly overgrown and out of range, I'm not going to put too much value in this particular section of the test. It just might tell me that you have a little bit of imbalance that we maybe need to nudge in the right direction, and that certainly doesn't require really strong antimicrobial protocols or antibiotics. Now on the next page, we have a bacterial section that's a little bit more of a gray area. So it's a section of bacteria that are supposed to be dysbiotic bacteria. So when they turn up, they tend to indicate that there's some sort of dysbiosis, or they're known to be autoimmune triggers or other potential triggers of further health problems. And so when I see some of these out of balance, again, maybe they need some more aggressive attention, but usually there's a lot that we can do with your health before we get to the point where we're, subjecting ourselves to antimicrobial protocols. So just for an example, changing your diet can actually provide a really radical shift in your microbiome within just a couple of weeks. And also regular courses of probiotics can also have the same effect. So again, out of balance results on this section of the test are not a cause for panic or concern. It's just an opportunity to say, okay, my gut's not looking great. Let's start with the low-hanging fruit, see how far we get. And if we still have a problem, then we can consider moving on to a more aggressive approach with the help of your healthcare provider. And one really key thing that I want to just point out, which is becoming a lot more clear to me as I work with people who have SIBO and other things like this, is that your symptoms don't necessarily correlate with what we see on this piece of paper. Sometimes it does, but sometimes dropping the amount of overgrown bacteria doesn't really resolve your symptoms. It may be that the cause of those symptoms has nothing whatsoever to do with the bacteria. So this just, again, reminds us that we always need to just keep backing up our approach to focusing on the basics, getting clear about what makes our symptoms better and worse, whether that's food, whether that's our sleep habits, whether that's our exercise habits, whether that's probiotics or, you know, whatever. So it's really important that we have this perspective and not just randomly grab at what we consider to be a possible silver bullet solution that really doesn't have anything necessarily to recommend it. And finally, at the bottom of the test, there's a number of digestive health markers that can be quite useful for you if you have chronic digestive problems. The first pair are elastase and steatocrit. Steatocrit is testing for fecal fat, so that's undigested fat in your stool. If steatocrit is elevated, this can indicate that you have a condition called bile acid malabsorption. And then elastase, if it's low, indicates a condition called exocrine pancreatic insufficiency. And so in both of these cases, there are parts of your food that are not being broken down properly for different reasons, and they can cause chronic diarrhea. So These values can be kind of interesting or useful for you if you're someone who has really chronic diarrhea. This can give you some good information that you can take to your doctor. And luckily, there are some really effective treatments for these conditions that can really help people clear these problems. Beta-glucuronidase is a marker that's supposed to correlate with bacterial activity. And so it sounds like that could be useful, but it seems like it really hasn't been very well validated. And there's a lot of different things that can alter the value of this number. So things as simple as just being a man versus a woman or how much you exercise or whatnot. So it's definitely a value that should be taken with a grain of salt. The next number is the occult blood. And if you have an elevation in this number, it's absolutely a time to run and not walk to go see your doctor. Blood in the stool can be a very serious side effect of some other more serious gut conditions. So definitely talk to your doctor if that number is elevated. And now the IgA numbers. So secretory IgA or SIgA is the mucus layer immune system that is a normal part of our gut physiology. And it's a really, really important part of our immune system. And the theory has it that an elevated level of secretory IgA is something that happens when you have a more acute gastrointestinal problem. And then a low value is said to indicate someone who's had a long-term chronic gut problem and the secretory IgA has over time just been sort of depleted and worn down. On the other hand, these lab values, again, haven't been very well validated scientifically. So, you know, they're maybe potentially interesting, but don't take them terribly, terribly seriously. And the anti-gliadin IgA is supposed to indicate that you're being exposed to gluten. And so sometimes people who are trying to do a gluten-free diet are using this number as a reference point for how their diet is going. I've typically seen these values over 100, even for people who are on very, very strict gluten-free diets. So I'm not really sure that this number really correlates very well with actual gluten exposure, unless it's very, very high and out of range. And then finally, calprotectin is a more standard and traditional lab marker that's supposed to correlate with inflammatory bowel syndrome. So if you have an elevated number for calprotectin, this is also a time when you should definitely make an appointment to talk to your doctor. So what does all this mean? Well, again, if you have any of the things that seem like more serious medical concerns, so these would be pathogenic bacteria, H. pylori infection, an elevated calprotectin, occult blood in your stool, you definitely want to go make an appointment with your doctor. But with the ordinary bacteria and the potential autoimmune trigger, potential dysbiotic bacteria, these results really just mean that first we need to pay some really good attention to your diet and lifestyle and things like probiotics and see if we can get a shift in your symptoms and some of these numbers that way. And if not, only then are you going to go move ahead to a more aggressive antimicrobial protocol. Have you ever run a GI map test? What did yours tell you? Tell me about it in the comments. So that's how to interpret a GI map stool test. Get the information, but don't panic. Get help from a doctor if you need, and then pay attention to your basic health foundations with your diet and your lifestyle piece to lay the groundwork for improving your overall health. If you're not sure how to do the basic digestive support, there's two main ways I can help you. The first is you can download my free guide, The Roadmap to Gut Recovery. In that guide, I give you the step-by-step process that I use with all of my clients, and that is the basic process for getting some of these foundational steps in place to improve your digestion. You can download your free copy of that by visiting confluencenutrition.com/roadmap, and I'll leave a link for that below this video. Or if you've already tried a lot and you're left feeling kind of confused about what's next or how you should proceed or sequence things for yourself, I'm an expert at helping people sift through all of these confusing details and helping you come up with a doable plan. If you want to learn more about working one-on-one with me, you can make yourself a free 30-minute assessment session with me. And then in that session, we can talk about what's going on for you, whether I can help you or not, and whether you'd like to move forward working with me. You can make that appointment by visiting confluencenutrition.com/contact, and I'll leave a link for that below this video as well. So I hope this video helped you feel confident about interpreting your GI map results and helps you understand that you don't need to panic about things on it. It's just really one more piece of information for moving your case forward. If you like this video, please click like and consider sharing it, and also consider subscribing. And I will be sure to see you next time. Take care.